last time I talked, a couple months ago, I decided that we would just start going through the book of First John. We got started on it, and that's where I'm gonna take it today. A little bit about First John. The letter of John, it doesn't seem to be addressed to any particular church. One source stated that it was a letter to be circulated among all the churches, and it was a letter to confirm their love for Jesus Christ and adherence to his teaching, following his teaching. This letter warned them of seducers, those that taught things other than love toward God, the church, and especially each other. If you don't love each other, your church is not going out to mud. You gotta love the Lord, but you gotta love each other for everything. Every part of the body is important. And this book fits today just like it did that day and time. And much can be learned from this book. I believe you can lead somebody to the Lord through this book. I believe it shows the Christian how to live a better life. It sure shows us how to deal with sin and get sin forgiven, and all which is very important. And I know in my life, because I'm a sinner, and it also, what I like about it, we'll be getting into, is it gets into the assurance you can have of your salvation. That's so important. You ever think about people maybe you've been talking to them that have no assurance at all that they're going to heaven until the day they die? They don't know when they go one way or the other. Well, there's no joy or no peace that I can see in a religion that does not show you that you're saved and you can know that you're saved. The last time, I was on the tractor from 8 o'clock till 4:30. Got a lot of dust down my crawl. Last time we talked, we just got in to looking at the deity of Christ. In other words, the God nature of Christ. And I'm going to go through a few of these. I don't really know how far I got. I didn't make me a spot where I stopped last time. But if you have a pencil and a pen and want to jot these down, I'm going to go through some of these pretty quick about the deity of Jesus Christ. In John 1:7, Jesus is called God by the Apostle John. In John 20:28, Jesus is called God by the Apostle Thomas. In Hebrews 1:8, Jesus is called God by God the Father. So that's pretty good. Pretty good news. In John 17:5, Jesus claimed to be God and in that he was with the Father before creation, before the world was ever made, he was with his Father. In John 8:51-59, he claimed to be God because he was before Abraham. Jesus received worship. And only God is to be worshipped. Jesus forgives sin, and only God can forgive sin. You find that in Mark 2:1-11. Only God can create and Jesus, as the Bible says, is the creator of all things. You can see that in Colossians 1, verses 12 through 17. John 1 and 3 tells us all things were made by him. That's Jesus Christ. Hebrews 1 and 2 tells us the whole world were made by him. Everything in the world, the worlds, even the universe, everything was made by him and for him. In 1 Corinthians 8 and 6, God and Jesus are the same and the maker of all things. Jesus is the sustainer of all things. Only God can control the universe or the worlds. Jesus claimed to have all power in heaven and earth, and only God has all power. Turn with me to Matthew 28. Verses 18 and 19 says, Matthew 28, 18 and 19, Jesus came and spake unto them, saying, all power is given unto me in heaven and earth. So God gave him all power. He's in control of everything. And with all the power he had, what did he tell us to do? Pretty good instructions there. You all know him, you probably to quote that, go ye therefore and teach all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost, teaching them to observe all things, whatever I have commanded you, and lo, I am with you always, even unto the end of the world. He wanted everyone to know how powerful he was and what he could do for them in the way of salvation and blessings in their life. Matthew, turn back just to Matthew 11. In verse 27, it says, Matthew 11, 27, Jesus speaking, all things are delivered unto me of my Father, and no man knoweth the Son but the Father, neither knoweth any man the Father save the Son, he to whomsoever the Son will reveal him. So, God and Jesus Christ are equal and both have all power. And let's go with the Old Testament right here in, to Daniel. Chapter 7. We'll read verses 13 and 14. Daniel 7, verses 13 and 14. I saw, talking about Jesus Christ, now, I saw in the night visions, and behold, one like the Son of Man came with the clouds of heaven and came to the Ancient of Days, and they brought him near before him. And there was given him dominion and glory and a kingdom, that all people, nations, and languages should serve him. His dominion is an everlasting dominion, which shall not pass away, and his kingdom that which shall not be destroyed. Don't you like a Savior like that? God like that? We're lucky. There's a lot of gods out there. They're dead. And we have a living Savior, living Heavenly Father. Now, let's go to 1 John. We'll read a few verses right there. I'll have to bear with me here. I think I told you last time. My 1 John is coming out of my Bible. First John, we'll read verses 2 and 3 of 1 John 1. Says, for the life was manifested, and we have seen it, job of Christ, and bear witness, and show unto you that eternal life which was with the Father and was manifested unto us, that which we have seen and heard, declare we unto you, that ye also may have fellowship with us, and truly our fellowship with the Father and with his Son, Jesus Christ. Manifest means to reveal or make public notice of something, to make plainly apparent to our sight, and most of all to our understanding, right up here. We understand, and then in our heart we understand also. Fellowship is usually between friends, and what greater friend than we have than Jesus Christ? John 15:14 will tell you that if you want to look that up. Sorry, my notes are out. They're a little messed up here. In verse 4, we read, "These things write we unto you, that your joy may be full." Jesus wants us to be happy, and he wants all our needs to be fulfilled. But sometimes our needs are not exactly what God would think they are. We have a need for a new car or a new washing machine. But maybe that's not the need he wants us to have. Maybe there's a need to have a heart that cares for other people, a heart that would even weep for other people, even not just your loved one, but for the lost. Brother George has got it there. We need a heart for the lost. I think a lot about the lost, and I feel so sorry for them. And then sometimes I miss an opportunity or a chance to witness, and then I feel bad. But the Lord wants us to love everyone, even our enemies and the lost in a caring way. In the book, verses that we read, John tells of all the, John 16:24. "Hitherto have you asked nothing in my name. Ask, and ye shall receive, that your joy may be full." And again, we have to be careful what we ask for. We need to ask for things that can help us in our Christian life and other people in their Christian life, or get them to the point where they are a Christian. John tells of all the marvelous things he has seen, he's heard, and even felt Jesus Christ. He shares these things that this group right here, reading it right now in this day and time, or whoever read this letter from the time it was written to up to now, they might have a greater fellowship with the Father and with Jesus Christ, and that their joy may be full. There's no greater thing we can see in this chapter is that you have peace and that you have joy in your life. And people will see that and will want that, or at least we hope they would. There's always the probability that someone in the churches or groups that read this letter did not know Jesus Christ as their Savior. I believe, as I was saying earlier, there's plenty in this book, and plenty of information here to convict someone of their sins and show them how to be saved. This letter could be used to exhort and guide each one of us, every Christian. There's something in there for all of us. Also, there's plenty there, as we said, to lead the lost to Christ. Now we're good for good. Let's read 1 John 4 or 5 verses, and then we'll go through them pretty quick. You're not going to get everything out of them like Brother George would give you. I mean, he's been a couple of days or lessons on just one of these verses, probably one word. But I just go through it and get what I can see myself easily. We're going to read verses, 1 John 1, verses 5 through 10. This then is the message that we have heard of him and declare unto you, that God is light, and in him is no darkness at all. If we say that we have fellowship with him and walk in darkness, we lie and do not the truth. But if we walk in the light, as he is in the light, we have fellowship one with another, and the blood of Jesus Christ, his Son, cleanses us from all sin. If we say that we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. If we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. If we say that we have not sinned, we make him a liar, and his word is not in us. We're lying too if we say that we have sinned. Here is the message we heard of him. Who was there? Okay. The disciples who followed Jesus, they were the messengers to the world. It was their mission, their obligation, their commandment to deliver the messages that they had heard and seen of Jesus Christ. Well, now, what was the message? Well, the message was God is light, and in him there is no darkness at all. Jesus was perfect. It was fitting for Jesus to be called the light. There was no darkness in Jesus. Darkness, we know, refers to the world. No sin in Jesus. The world is full of sin and imperfections. John 8:12 tells you that. Turn with me to John, first chapter of John. John 1:6-9. There was a man sent from God whose name was John. The same came for witness, to bear witness of the light, Jesus Christ, that all men through him might believe. He was not that light, but was sent to bear witness of that light. That was the true light, which lighteth every man that cometh into the world. Let's just read a little further right here. He was in the world, and the world was made by him, and the world knew him not. Isn't that sad to read that? He came unto his own, and his own received him not. And that's still happening today. But as many as received him, to them gave he power to become the sons of God, even to them that believe on his name. I feel like we've all done that, you know. So we have light, in a way, in our life as we have Jesus Christ in our minds and in our hearts. John the Baptist was a messenger like John the Apostle. Isaiah 40:3 prophesies his coming. John the Baptist was not the light. Some thought he was at that time. Some thought he was the Christ. But he was not. But he was a light, as each Christian should be. Each one of us is a light to this world out here, this lost world. We hear children sing this song, "This Little Light of Mine, I'm gonna let it shine, let it shine, let it shine." Well, that should be the song of every Christian. That should be in our heart, that our light would shine. What is the little light? Well, it's our love for Jesus. If people can't see your love for Jesus, you're not going to have much effect to get them to love Jesus enough to accept him as their Savior. And also, the light, I believe, is the testimony, our testimony that we can give of how we were saved, our salvation. Very important. Could you, if you were called up from the church, could you give a good, clear testimony of how you were saved? Or if you were talking to a friend or just someone you met, could you give a clear testimony of your salvation? Something to think about, maybe something to jot down and work on. No, there are times and opportunities that will come along for you to do that. Jesus Christ was the light and still is the true light. And what's more important, will always be the true light. This verse says, "Jesus lighteth every man that cometh into the world." Well, how does that happen? How does he light everybody up? He enlightens every man with the power of reason. God made these bodies. And he gave us a conscience, and he gave us a brain to use. And if we use them in the right way, there'll be a blessing to Jesus Christ. He allows each person to make up his own mind about any and every issue. And we're pretty stubborn, aren't we, sometimes, about making our mind up about something and not changing it, even when we can sometimes see that we're wrong. His gospel is available in some form or fashion to every country or nation, every person. We can see that in nature. If it's not in something written, it's just in nature and how God made something. Through the gospel, each person can receive the light if he's willing to. I have a quote here, but I didn't put down who it was said. That's my fault. Whatever light any man has, he is indebted to Christ for it, whether it be natural or supernatural. Matthew 5:14-16 says, we are to share the light we receive and not hate it. And I'm pretty good about not letting my light shine like I should. I believe you or we can compare the light we're talking about here to love. The more love a person has, the brighter the light he sheds, you just see, I see people, some people in this church, they just bubble over. They're so happy with being a Christian and the joy and peace that brings, and share it. The more love a person has, the brighter the light he sheds. In verse 6, it said, are we liars? We are if we go the way of the world. If our lives are full of sin, we cannot be in fellowship with Christ. John 8:12 tells us we cannot walk in darkness and have fellowship with Christ. But it's easy to get that fellowship back. We'll see that. If we walk in the light, as Jesus is in the light, not only will we be in fellowship with Christ, but we can enjoy fellowship with other saints. If we're out of fellowship with Christ, it's hard to have fellowship with your brothers and sisters in Christ. If you're out of fellowship with your brothers and sisters in Christ, you're not going to have any fellowship with Jesus Christ either. That's just not going to happen. If you don't love the brother, you can break your fellowship with Jesus Christ. You've got to get these things right again with that brother, sister, whatever it might be. The blood of Jesus Christ cleanses us from all sin. When we were first saved, Jesus Christ's blood saved us from the sins that we had already accrued and cleared the slate, but we have sins that we commit daily, and we have to get Jesus Christ to forgive those things by going to him. But it's still because of the precious blood that we have this forgiveness. 1 Corinthians 6:11 says, and such were some of you, but ye are washed, but ye are sanctified, but ye are justified in the name of the Lord Jesus and by the Spirit of our God. And such were some of you, that's everyone in here. There was a time that we did not know Jesus Christ as our Savior. One more little thing here, and we'll stop. It's about the blood. Have you ever thought about using blood as a cleanser? We just read that it cleanses us from sin, but what about using blood as a cleanser in our household? You know, instead of a tithe or something, would that work? It only stains. My blood, your blood, we cut ourselves. I've got shirts now, but at least I can't get the stains out because I didn't get in cold water quick enough. Get the blood in the cold water when I cut myself or something. But it'll ruin clothing. There's no cleansing power in our blood. But look at what the Christ, Jesus Christ's blood can do. It cleansed me, it cleansed you, and it's still cleansing anyone that would accept him as their Lord and Savior. And we're gonna stop right there, and I'm gonna make you mark this time where I stopped. And there's some really good stuff there. I'm sorry I didn't bring it out the way I wanted to. And I'm not going to blame it on not having time. That's just one of those things. But I appreciate y'all coming. Maybe this is something we can use in our daily lives as we witness to those around us, and again, witness, but just